So, as was just mentioned, I was a PhD student with Basil some years ago. Working on imputed order and quantum theory. But one of the things that I learned from Basil was not to have a closed mind and to always look for places where you could find new insight. And so, while I was here doing my PhD, one of the things you were always telling me to think about was the brain and how you could explain the brain. So I was very interested in biology as well as quantum theory. And so after I'd finished my PhD with Basil, I actually moved into working in biology. And one of the things I've always wanted to do is try to find ways of taking the ideas that Basil and David Bohm and others have thought about in terms of process in the context of physics and apply them to, or see how they apply in biology. Because I'd like to start with a quote from David Bohm. Well, I should first say, it's just a stained glass window. It's some nice pictures, at least. I just wanted to put this up to illustrate something about biology. Biology is wonderful. Life is wonderful. It's a rich diversity of forms and behaviors. It's fundamentally dynamic. There wouldn't be the meaning of life without it being a dynamic process. It clearly is a dynamic process. And this is just a nice illustration of many different forms that we see in biology. But there's a paradox in the way that we do biology. And this is a quote from David Bohm from 1976. When molecular biology was only really just starting to get going, only just started to be possible in around about 1976 to start to look at gene function. So the idea of a gene was older. The idea of a gene was actually a process idea originally. It was units of inheritance, and it was about the process of inheritance. But by the mid-70s, genes had become an atomistic idea. It was a thing that was transmitted between generations that had agency, that could do things. Genes did things. And so people were now, in the mid-70s, able to start to have the tools to actually start delving down and seeing what were the structure of these genes and what were they doing. And so Bohm felt it necessary already in the 70s to point out that we arrive at this odd result, but in the study of life and mind, which are just the fields in which forms of cause acting in undivided and unbroken flowing movements, is most evident to experience and observation. I think we all know that. There's now the strongest belief in the fragmentary atomistic approach to reality. So physics had gone through the transition with quantum mechanics of having to move away to some extent from determinism and start to worry about properties of whole systems and wave functions describing whole setups. And biology was moving more and more towards a fragmented atomistic approach of trying to find genes to explain everything and go down a particulate type approach. And so this was already clearly worrying David in the mid-1970s. And of course things have only become more polarized since then, really, as the ability to delve down and find the components underlying life has increased, then so the worldview, if you like, the way that people think about biology, certainly practitioners of biology, is that it's moved much more towards this atomistic type reductionist approach of trying to just explain things in terms of genes. So I've got two truisms here, which are not just about biology, but just generally about how we do science. The first is that change is universal. So we like to think of, we try to draw static pictures in order to explain things. Because I would say explanation is always projection down onto a different space. If you're trying to explain a system rather than describe a system, you're actually projecting it onto something else to say that's a representation of it. An explanation is a representation. And we tend to do that in terms of static things. Unless you say things like, well, it's process. And then people say, so what's process? And you say, it becomes difficult because it's not something that you can point to. You know, there's process. Although it is, people say, no, that's a thing. That's not a process, that's a thing. And so we do that. It's a natural tendency. The other truism is that any attempt to explain reality is only a perspective. It can only ever be a perspective. And no one perspective can capture all aspects of reality. Reality is reality, and then explanations are perspectives on reality. And that's a pragmatic limitation, of course. We're not the all-knowing, all-seeing, non-interacting observer. But it's also, it's pragmatic, but we can't know everything about a system. But that's also a fundamental limitation of the idea of actually explaining things, of explanation. So these are truisms, and they tend to, they put limitations on what you can do with explanation, different modes of explanation. But how do they have consequences for biology? And why is it pertinent to think about these questions now? So in the mid-70s, when David Bohm wrote that work I just quoted, the technologies were only just there to start investigating single genes. And biologists have exploited this quite rightly to learn the properties of these components of biological systems and start to see nice links between the structure down at the genetic level and behavior of organisms, by which I mean the whole phenotype of organisms. And that's been an appropriate methodology and an appropriate philosophy or worldview to go with that is a reductionist worldview. That's fine, there's nothing wrong with that, so long as you accept it's a perspective. But we're at a stage now where methodological advances in the life sciences, in biology and medicine, from technologies like genome sequences, like very high throughput expression profiling of systems to work out exactly what genes are expressed at what levels, in what tissues, at high temporal resolution. Advances in microscopy, so that we can now get very high resolution, time-resolved images of what cells are actually doing, what tissues are doing. They're now giving data that are at the level of systems behavior with also information about the parts. So we now have these enormous data sets. You can generate terabytes of data from microscopes in a few hours now, where there's an enormous amount of information in there. You have to say, well, how do we actually explain what's going on? How do we project down from those enormously high-dimensional data sets to some kind of explanation? What is the appropriate way of doing that? So there's a pragmatic issue here. What do we do with all these data? We're generating ludicrous quantities of data at such a rate that nobody can even actually look at it. There was not the microscopy that's going on now, there isn't time to look at the images even, to look at the movies. So what do we do with them? Do we have machine learning algorithms that can go into these data and somehow pull out meaning? They can pull out correlations, but they can't pull out meaning, they can't pull out explanations. So one route, and there's quite a move towards this, is saying, well, we have large computational power as well, let's just develop algorithms for learning. Machine learning is a big thing. Let's take big data, throw it at big machines, and they will tell us that the patterns will emerge and the patterns will make sense. So that's one way of doing it, but maybe that's not the wisest way to seek explanation and to seek meaning from these data. And so that leads to the question of how do we project down from these massive data? How do you project down onto something that you can actually form a meaning from? And that is the question, what perspective should we adopt when we're in this situation of having this ability to probe into these systems, these incredibly complicated systems? So how do we project down? So I'd like to suggest that these new methodologies and these new opportunities deserve new perspectives. I put new in inverted commas, of course, because I'm going to suggest that a natural way of thinking about biological systems and a natural way of trying to project down from these data is a process view. And so these are old ideas from these classic thinkers, Heraclitus, Aristotle, Leibniz, Bergson, Whitehead. It's not an exhaustive list at all, highly. I stole this picture from Facebook recently. I really like this picture.
Where was it taken?
I don't know. You're on a bench with Pavo and somebody else.
Why is my hand up in the air?
I don't know. Revolution. So here's my aim in mind. Can you actually set about developing a process of perspective biology? And particularly, I want to be pragmatic. So it's fine, you can talk about process and say this is clearly the right way to think about reality. But Is there an opportunity for actually doing something in biology here that a process perspective would help with? Now, here's another quote. This is the only other quote I'll put up. This is a classic statement in biology. Nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. And so I really like this quote because a lot of biologists like to quote this all the time, just in abstract, just that one sentence. Perhaps you like this quote from the paper, but most biologists who quote that top one would probably be a bit uncomfortable about putting up because of some of the things it says in there. I'm a creationist and an evolutionist. Evolution is God's or nature's method of creation. Creation is not an event that happened in 4004 BC. It's a process that began some 10 billion years ago and is still underway. So I love the work of Andy Goldsworthy, who's an artist who works with natural materials. And to me, this work of his illustrates that quote very nicely and illustrates what I'd like to talk about. This is evolution, of course. Keep up. And two ways of looking at this. You can either see a sequence of generations of individuals, the stones in here, or an unbroken line formed from those things. Those are two perspectives on that same thing. And the atomistic genetic approach focuses on the individuals, individual generations. But there's also, through that, this continuing line of evolution from the origin of life to now. It's an ongoing process. So how can we actually get some insight into this? And it's already been mentioned that Basil puts the maths in to all the process thinking. So this goes down a mathematical route, but I'm not going to show equations on a Sunday morning. So thinking about this process of evolution, clearly individuals exist. There is a basic unit of biology, it's a basic unit of life, the individual. And there's inheritance from generation to generation that constitutes this process. So what's inherited? We need to know that for a start, if we have this unbroken process. Well, ideas about what's inherited go back a long time. It was, at one point, believed from early microscopy, it was believed that this was what we could see if you looked at sperm under a microscope. So, Hartsucker was involved in development of the microscope, and of course, if you were the person who invented the microscope and you were male, what would be the first thing you'd look at? So you'd look at sperm, of course, because that's what you do if you get a microscope. And he thought he could see this, homunculus. But what was inherited was the form, or intact, the intact form, that then just grew. So there was a direct propagation of form from one generation to the next. That was then, it was clear that that wasn't the case, but actually it was more interesting than that, that what was inherited was an embryo, or well, a fertilized egg, effectively, that could then generate the body plan. And that's what I work on, is development, the process of going from a fertilized egg cell to a body plan. But we moved on, and then we realized that, of course, what's inherited is actually chromosomes and DNA. That's the important thing, not even the whole fertilized egg, it's just the chromosomes. It's DNA that matters. That's what you really inherit, and we can move that DNA around from cell to cell, and it doesn't really matter. It's the DNA that generates the form. And so you get the whole idea of cloning and related areas. And that's true, you do inherit DNA, but is that all you inherit? And what you're really inheriting is networks. So those chromosomes have DNA, are made of DNA, which have genes on them, which code for things that interact, that generate complicated networks that then generate that body plan that you see. That will do the actual work of generating body plans. So you're inheriting networks. So if that's the kind of substrate, that's where we stand in terms of what we believe is inherited. So where's selection acting on all this? Because of course the other strand of evolution is selection. Well, that's just what's inherited from generation to generation, but what gives a direction to evolution? What causes change? And that's believed to be selection on phenotypes, on the way that those the networks that you inherit get expressed in terms of behavior, cellular behavior and tissue behavior and organism behavior. And so what evolution is doing is taking traits or aspects of phenotype and applying selective pressure to them by reproductive success and leading to drifts in terms of traits or phenotypes. But phenotypes are not static things. Again, population biologists sometimes like to think of phenotypes as a static thing, but a phenotype is a dynamic process in its own right. It's a dynamic life history. And what's more, this process of development plays a critical role in establishing phenotype. Phenotype doesn't just emerge from the genome in a simple way, it works through a complicated process in its own right. So phenotypes depend on genotypes, but not simply. And so we need to ask this question, so how does the evolution of genotypes relate to the evolution of phenotypes? And that raises this whole question of genotype-phenotype maps. And here's an old schematic picture form, which I quite like. But we have, so the idea is that at the fundamental level, we have a set of gene frequencies in a population, because we're going to try to explain things in terms of genes, that they, in turn, code for these networks that have, they effectively set the components and parameters for networks, dynamic networks, the developmental parameters in here, which then leads to phenotypes, which then is a selective filter on those that leads to the actual realized phenotypes that you see in a population. So that's a more or less conventional view of evolutionary dynamics, that you've got this principal unit of inheritance down here in the terms of the genes, and that it then gets expressed in terms of phenotypes through this map, the genotype to phenotype map up here. But natural selection's acting up here on phenotypes. That's what gets selected, that's what leads to your fitness, is phenotypes. It's not acting down here. There's no selection acting down here, so there needs to be something that feeds back in here. And how does that work? Now, this mapping is complex. It's very complicated mapping, and it's not simple. So what's being selected in here? So I just want to spend a few minutes talking about some aspects of that map from genotype to phenotype. The first is that, so that's going through development. That's how you go, that's how a network generates pattern, morphogenesis. And that works well in the face of all sorts of significant perturbations, and has to if you're going to have a stable motion of a species. There needs to be a reasonably robust map from genotype to phenotype because it has to do so in the face of all sorts of perturbations. So it has to be reasonably robust. And it has this adaptive capacity. It does the act thing. It does the right thing, which is quite incredible about life. This is what, so a lot of mathematicians who work in developmental biology are interested in pattern formation because you see wonderful patterns in life. But non-living systems do wonderful patterns as well. What's different about living systems is that they do so in an adaptive way. They know where they're going. They know where they want to go, if you'll allow me that language. So there seems to be a purpose in development. And I don't mean anything spiritual by that, but that's what life is characterized by. There's no single path from an egg to an adult. There's many equivalent paths. And so I don't do experiments, but this is the only experiment I've done in biology, as I've seen this before. So this individual here came from a single fertilized egg cell and formed that very nice morphology. And so did these two. They also came from a single fertilized egg cell that, after many rounds of division, decided for some reason to split into two, and rather than getting two half children like this, you get two perfectly formed normal children. Not even smaller. Not particularly. Born a little bit earlier, but still, by the time they reach their birth date, they reach the same size as a normal. It's an incredible adaptive capacity when you think about it. How do you do that? How would you actually engineer a system to do that? It's not, you know, we're nowhere near understanding how you can do that kind of thing. But it shows this adaptive capacity for the system, for this developmental process. And what must be going on in there, and this, you know, you can put much more concrete data to these, and much more specific genetic data to these, rather than just looking at twins and saying, wow, that's fantastic. There's a normal, if you like, benign emergence from local interactions to global coordination, the idea of self-organization, the idea of emergence and complex behavior, which is extremely interesting and has lots of fun in it, and a good thing to spend your life technically doing. But this adaptive capacity stems from some kind of top-down regulation. There's a purpose, there's a direction in this process. And I like to call that spooky holism. I'm paraphrasing Einstein a little bit, but there's this, which is genuinely spooky. How do you do that? And professionally, if you want to understand the emergence, the origin of this in terms of genetic interactions, it's really hard. Actually studying where, mechanistically, where those things come from. What are these system-level controls on local behaviours, and how do biological systems implement that? So it's a lot of fun in looking at that arrow as well. And it's that's kind of day job arrow is trying to understand that and this to an extent. But anyway, another aspect of that map is that it's not one-to-one. It's not a bijective map going from genotype to phenotype. So we've seen already that there are many paths, so you can perturb this thing as it goes along and it still knows where it wants to go. But something that's extremely widespread in that developmental process is that it can also go in different directions depending on context. And this is most strikingly seen in polyphenism, where an individual organism with the same genotype, the same genetic complement, can develop into two or more different morphologies depending on the environment. And one example of that, this is a nice example of Daphnium, the water fleas that you see in pond water. Depending on whether or not there's a predator present, or actually just a single chemical that can be isolated from these predators, if there isn't, they develop in this morphology. And if there is, they develop this big helmet, big spiny helmet that makes them rather unpalatable to predators. And this has a selective advantage, that if you develop these helmets, then you have about 90% survival in the presence of a predator compared to about 40% if you don't. So it's selective pressure for this. And this is just induced by this chemical during development. It causes a bifurcation in the developmental pathway. You go one of two different ways. It's heritable. It's a heritable trait for several generations. It's not a genetic change, it's an epigenetic change. But so that actually shows you already that you don't just inherit genetic states, you inherit information about your environment as well. And it's often thought that that's an unusual case, because those are just strange examples. But they're not. There's actually lots of these. These are just some schematic examples where all across the whole spectrum of life, you get polyphenism in this very quite radical morphological sense. So polyphenism, people just think about radically different morphologies. But in terms of behaviors, in terms of lifetime propensities to certain behaviors, it's totally widespread that you inherit all sorts of things apart from genetic information from your parents. And these are just survivorship. So these all have selective advantage, these different morphologies that have been well demonstrated. So this simple genotype-phenotype map thing needs to be modified, because the original picture in there suggests that there's this deterministic path, basically, from a genotype to a phenotype. But it's not, because it's clear that environment plays a significant role in this process. And so what genotypes actually encode are sets of potentialities for a system, propensities to do certain things. And that's influenced by the environment, which may be deterministic or it may be stochastic. And so we don't have a simple mapping. And what's more, the environment actually depends on your complement of realized phenotypes. And so we've got a feedback in here, that actually this process depends on what you've got at this level. So the actual genotype-phenotype map depends on what phenotypes you've got around. So we're really dealing with genotype-phenotype maps. Well, I said no maths, I've put non-bijective in here, that's a mathematical term. I won't go any more maths than that. But rather than this simple picture of a genotype mapping to a phenotype in a one-to-one way, we've got robustness that shows us we have many-to-one, and polyphenism that shows us we have one-to-many maps. And those are widespread and totally normal in genotype-phenotype maps. They're all, they all exhibit both those aspects. So how do we deal with that? So the way that we're looking at that is to actually formalize this idea of a genotype-phenotype map in terms of dynamical systems. These are dynamical systems. Genotypes specify a network topology in terms of which genes are interacting with which in various ways. That's the way that people think about it. Plus interaction parameters, the strengths at which these interact. And so the idea is you're inheriting this set of parameters and this network, and it goes off and does its stuff, and maybe gets some input from the environment. What does it tell us about the genotype-phenotype map, though? The important thing to realize, so I'm using phase space in a dynamical systems way rather than momentum and position in here, we might hear about phase spaces later. The key thing is that what are the natural descriptors in this kind of view? So if we're going to have a different philosophical approach, then we need to know what are our natural descriptors. If I want a process approach, what kind of things am I going to describe it in terms of? I can't just say it's process, because people then say, okay, do something, show me something. But if you just think about dynamical systems, and here's a really, really simple one, a two-component dynamical system, let's say they're genes, but they don't have to be genes, they can be anything, X and Y that repress each other in some way and also self-activate themselves, although that's not necessary for this picture, then if we want to understand the behaviors, the possible behaviors of that system, then the things we talk about in dynamical systems are attractors, whether they're fixed points or cycles or chaotic attractors, but they're where the system will move to, what kind of dynamics will it end up exhibiting. Associated with those basins of attraction, separating them, you have separatrices. The actual what happens to the system is described by trajectories, those are dynamic things. And importantly, the key thing, if I write this down in terms of a set of differential equations or in terms of a set of logical equations, Boolean equations, I need initial conditions. A system is not described just by the dynamical equations, but you also need initial conditions to actually generate trajectories from this. Without the initial conditions, all it gives you is a set of propensities to do things. So if we're going to inherit one of these systems, if that's the unit of inheritance, that's a key component of the unit of inheritance, the initial conditions, and boundary conditions and all the other conditions that we need to actually implement this system. But what this does, this provides you with a different menu of basic descriptors for the dynamics of living systems. Because people take these data and they try to interpret it in terms of the components and the interactions. Those are supposedly the key descriptors, key basic descriptors, components and interactions. But if you accept that they're a dynamical system, this is a different set of basic descriptors. And for people who do dynamical systems, this is just obvious. But it has exactly the properties that genotype-phenotype maps have. Single genotype, even for the simplest network of two components, has a different phenotype token to it for the same parameters, and it depends on which initial conditions you give it. If I start just down here, I'm in the blue basin of attraction and I go to a steady state here. If I'm in this salmon pink basin of attraction, just very slightly different initial conditions, I move down a trajectory to a different steady state, a different phenotype. So this is a banal, trivial example, but even in this simplest example, there are two phenotypes for this genotype, depending quite subtly sometimes on initial conditions. So immediately, we have this idea of multiple attractors, multiple possible phenotypes for a single genotype. Phenotypes correspond to these whole trajectories. And again, you can cause quite significant perturbations to trajectories. So long as you preserve the attractors and you stay in the same basin, you've got robustness, you've got adaptive capacity. They'll take a different route, but they'll still get there. That's exactly what genotype-phenotype maps do. So these are non-bijective maps that have the right properties for what we see in the genotype-phenotype map. So evolution can work with a lot more than just parameters in these networks. So evolution is typically thought of as changing the genes or changing their interactions. But this asks you, well, actually, is evolution about changing the phase portrait, changing the phase space? And there's a lot more to changing the phase space than just changing the genes and their interactions. That gives you several different mechanisms. Potential mechanisms for evolution, if you think of it in terms of dynamical systems. So here's our little switch that we were just talking about. We have two basins of attraction, the colours have changed now, I think. I don't know, I'm sort of blind. Is that green, I think?
Green.
That's green, yeah. So it's gone green here. I'm hopeless with colours. Anyway, so here's our wild type. Here's our standard trajectory, if you like. Starting from these initial conditions, going to this steady state, this phenotype, is that trajectory there. And the ideas of gradualism, Darwinian gradualism, is basically that by tuning the genes and their interactions, you move phenotypes around gradually. So that would be a shift in the attractor position because I've changed the strengths of the interactions in there. So I get basically the same thing, but now I've got a slightly larger beak than I had before, or a slightly different coloration, or some slightly different pattern. That's gradual change from a position here to a position here in face space. And that's what people immediately think of with gradual evolution. You also have the possibility, of course, that if you change the strengths of interactions, you can go through a bifurcation in the dynamical system and introduce a whole new steady state. So in this case, we can have a stalemate steady state if we make these self-interactions strong enough. And then it may be that my initial conditions will take me to a different steady state. I get a sudden transition. So that leads to these ideas of punctuated evolution with periods of gradual or no change, interspersed by radical changes, kind of instantaneous radical changes. That's almost like a separatrix has moved over our initial conditions, taking me into a new basin here. But it's a new basin for a totally new type of phenotype. This is innovation in here. But what, and these two are the kind of, these are the bread and butter of evolution, those two things. But actually, we have different ways of generating alternative phenotypes in here. And we can either, if we change initial conditions, so we now move into a different basin of attraction, we get a different phenotype. That's like polyphenism. So if you put a predator chemical in, and that starts development off to different initial condition, I now go to a different steady state, different phenotype. But equally, changes in either the environment or the genome can actually lead to the shift of separatrices. They don't change the steady state, they don't change the phenotype, but they change where the boundaries between the basins are for those phenotypes. And if you now imagine a population, I've drawn a single point on here, but a population is actually a cloud in here. It's a cloud of initial conditions, and it's a cloud of these states, of these phase spaces themselves. If you start to move those boundaries, you're actually changing propensities for things to happen in that population. So you're changing frequencies of things happening by doing that, without actually changing the phenotypes. So that's a different way of doing evolutionary change, and a different way of thinking about evolutionary change. And the key thing is, then, is that changes in genotypes can move separatrices that result in changes in sensitivity to conditions. And I'll just say something about that in a moment. But in the context of this map, we're starting to bring in these feedbacks. So this is one that's conventionally thought about, genetic inheritance. But we know we also have maternal inheritance, conditions, initial conditions. And there's good evidence for that. And so what you're really inheriting is a whole dynamical process. So it is actually a process that's inherited from generation to generation. And there are ways of formalizing that statement in terms of dynamical systems. So what's inherited is this whole process, developmental process, and by development I mean a whole lifetime development, not just embryonic development, that's really encoding potentialities or propensities rather than predetermined behaviors. So you're not just inheriting something that determines your behavior. You're inheriting something that gives you potentialities and propensities. And it's integrating genetic, maternal, and environmental factors all together to produce phenotypes. And so there's a huge overlap between development and evolution. They have a common substrate. And they've traditionally been thought of as two separate disciplines, development and evolution. And this kind of view starts to bring them much closer together, where you can't really think of one without the other. They don't really make sense, neither makes sense except in the light of the other. And so I'm not really happy with this schematic. I can't really find a good schematic for this, but what we think about, a population geneticist thinks about changes in allele frequencies in populations. So that's genetic change over time. The frequency of different alleles of a gene changes over time. And that seems as a discrete generational thing with inheritance at this level. But what I hope I've at least put forward and not persuaded you of, is that this is only an aspect of this deeper underlying continuous dynamical process that's going on. That is, yes, there's an aspect of inheritance to that, but it is actually an ongoing unbroken process. That you're inheriting, through this dynamical system, conditions that are from the state of the dynamical system. So the dynamical system is reproducing itself with its initial conditions, and the environment then influences that. And so to put this in the context of where I started, which was thinking about implicate order and explicate order, when I was doing my PhD, so when I left Birkbeck, I wanted to go away and find a way of using implicate order in what I was interested in, which was developmental biology. I wasn't thinking of evolution at the time. But there, a rephrasing of what I've just said, is that on genotype space, we have this change over time of allele frequencies. That's what people think of traditionally as the substrate of evolution. Your allele frequencies are changing. Corresponding to that, in phenotype space, we have evolution of phenotype. And those two are linked traditionally by development that goes from your genetic complement, your genotype, to your phenotype, and then, of course, to go through the generations, you have inheritance of this process of a phenotype leading to the inheritance of a new genotype. But what I've shown is that one way of thinking about that is that the common substrate for both of these things is this dynamical system of life that we're interested in. Those two at the top and bottom are the explicate orders. Those are where we see this manifest discrete change. This is where we think of dynamics. These are the observable dynamics, if you like. And this is the implicate order of which they're both expressions of. They're two distinct explicate orders from this one implicate order. And this is where the logic lies, and this is where the process view rests naturally. That's my proposal, is that this is where we look for a process understanding of life, is in that common dynamical system of which these are explicate orders. And we're not going to find it in either of these explicate orders. Those have the manifest orders, but the underlying process order is in here. And this has the natural descriptors to do it. So why is that important now? So one reason for that, which is pragmatic, is that we have all these genomic data. So each of us could get sequenced tomorrow if we wanted to. It's not very expensive. You could get your whole genome sequenced. And it would tell you that you carry a certain number of things called SNPs, which are single nucleotide polymorphisms. These are single base changes in DNA that through very large-scale association studies that people have done, called genome-wide association studies, have found that particular changes in the DNA, single base changes in DNA, lead to changes in lifetime propensity for certain things to happen to you, whether it's to get breast cancer or prostate cancer or to develop heart disease, and they have very powerful associations from looking at huge population-wide data. That's interesting. That's nice. And some of them have been picked off because they have a simple one-to-one mapping to a very clear thing that's happened. So you may have heard of BRCA1 and BRCA2, which are two genes which have specific mutations in them that lead to a much higher risk of developing breast cancer, to the extent that people, when they find out they have BRCA1 and BRCA2, will have mastectomies as a preventative measure because they know that they have a very high propensity of developing breast cancer. Those SNPs are a tiny proportion of all the SNPs, and nearly all SNPs have no simple link to any genetic, any phenotypic change in cells, any change in gene expression. So this is a project that we're trying to do, is say, well, what do you do with these very small effect SNPs? They're changing my propensities in interesting ways, and I want to know how I can't get rid of the SNP, but how could I maybe bring my propensities back down a bit? What might I do to help ameliorate the fact that I've got these SNPs that increase my propensity for certain illnesses. So what do? I need to project it down onto something that I can understand mechanistically. And if you try to project it down onto genes, it doesn't work. Are these SNPs in known genes? Or in genes? No. Are they in regions that are known to regulate the expression of those genes? No. Can I find in the huge amounts of data any evidence that they change gene expression? No. None of those things. You try to project down onto the descriptors, the genetic descriptors, and it doesn't work. They don't do anything. They don't do anything mechanistically. So what do you do? How do you understand the mechanism of action of these SNPs? You need different descriptors to project down onto. So what, you know, so people don't look at them, so you don't hear about them because there's nothing to say about them, apart from there's a linkage, there's an association, there's a correlation. But we want mechanism. If we want to be able to do this wonderful dream of personalized medicine, we need mechanism. So what's the mechanism? What might they be changing? They're changing propensities, so they're doing things like moving separatrices, they're changing sensitivities. Because what if I've got a propensity, an increased propensity of developing prostate cancer at age 60, that's not something that's wrong with my cells earlier on. It's something, it's changing their sensitivity to things. So how do we deal with understanding how genes change sensitivities to behaviors? That's in terms of dynamical systems. Now it's a process view. I would claim that's a process view. And so there are pragmatic reasons for trying to adopt these different points of view, different basic descriptors. So I hope I've at least shown you, if not persuaded you, that there is a different way to think about evolution, about development, that doesn't have to project down just onto genes, acting as agents that conspire to do things, but there are actually ways of bringing in the systems level of behavior to the individuals and seeing this as this much more satisfying to me, unbroken process of development and evolution. So thank you for your attention.
Just brings the public, well, not necessarily, but the whole idea of process into a totally different field, which I'm not, day to day, I have absolutely no knowledge of particularly. Great, George, please, far yes. Away.
Let me make a comment. In the biology, in molecular biology, and you're studying a cell, and you see, you're looking at, you have a cell cancer, it's some kind of cells, you add a certain substance to that, and then you, by a sophisticated technology, you can see exactly what genes are expressed, and are they activated or deactivated. And there are thousands. For each substance, there are 1,000. And say you have one substance, and you have a map, like a set, which are either activated or deactivated. Mm-hmm. Then you have another substance, do the same experiment, and you have another set of genes which are activated, deactivated. Now, what is happening is when you combine this two substances in the same solution, as it were, in the same physiological solution, then a different set, which is not the union of the two others, expressed. And in fact, that some genes were not expressed, but activated by any of those two subjects are activated now. So I think this falls very well in with your scheme.
Yeah.
But do you have some comment there to that?
So, yes, yeah, so things certainly act in a combinatorial way that leads to consequences that are not just the sum of those. And that's a natural feature of dynamical systems, that you can make two independent changes and the consequence of both changes will not be the sum of those individual changes. It might take you through a bifurcation, but individually they don't, for example. But more generally, it's how I would interpret things like that is that those are both, they're changing the whole phase portrait of your system. So if you just think of the genes giving you a behavior, that set of genes in this cell gives me this behavior. I put the chemical in, all it's doing is just modulating that behavior. But you're actually modulating the whole dynamical system. And so you're modulating all the propensities in there to respond to other things, because you've now changed the whole phase portrait. So now, so you're thinking of two different things. If you put individual changes on, you're just making changes to the phase portrait. And that may, or, you know, that leads to different patterns of gene expression. But if you change the phase portrait one way, you now have different sensitivities to other things. So it fits in naturally with this type of view.
Okay, any more questions, Jeff?
I just one more philosophical note, question. You raised the issue of what does it mean to explain and understand in the context of dynamical systems theory, as opposed to reductionistic terms. And I think that's what we're also struggling with in our programs. And I think many people who are engaged in this idea of emergent self-organization dynamical systems, do we really have an explanation when we use holistic concepts? Because we're so much in the habit of thinking explanation is atomistic,
yes,
or genetic or reductionistic. Can you comment on that?
Okay, so I'm not sure we have a holistic view yet, but to give an example, a simple example of where this is actually happening, and not necessarily from people who would classify themselves as process philosophers. So there's a nice process during development that generates segmentation of your body. It's called somatogenesis. And you want to build, your ribs are the evidence of this process that happens in the embryo. And it's a sequential process in which you lay down blocks of tissue called somites. And that's done by a clock. There's an oscillator in the tissue, and as you have growth, that leads to generation of somites. So nice, simple process. And people have looked into this and found the genes underlying this, and you can start to build elaborate networks that underlie this process and try to understand how they're generating this. And it's an incredibly robust process. So you have the right number of ribs always, pretty much. That never goes wrong. And so what people have been doing over the last 10, 15 years, myself included, is building more and more sophisticated models of this, reductionist models of this. And actually, your explanatory power goes down as you do this. So it's a naive assumption that if you put more and more detail in a model, your explanatory power goes up. Unfortunately, in the face of limited data, your explanatory power starts to go down again because your uncertainty goes up. So you have this kind of parabolic explanatory power graph that goes up and comes back down as you put more detail in. And so where's this sweet spot of where you actually have the most explanatory power? And there's a researcher who's now based at UCL, actually, called Andrew Oakes, who's an experimentalist who works on this, working with a theoretician called Frank Ulico, who came up with a much, much simpler model of all of this, that cut through all of this complexity and said, it's just a hot bifurcation. And it may pose it specifically in terms of dynamical systems. And a generic Hopf bifurcation will have these properties. If you can find a way of modulating this in this way, the response will be this. Do the experiment, that's exactly what it does. Now that actually has a perfect explanatory power at the level that we have the ability to control this system and manipulate it and generate data. And it's in terms of a system property. It's just saying the system has Hopf bifurcation and it's just close to this Hopf bifurcation. And therefore it will respond to noise in this way, it will respond to modulation in this way, and it's the perfect explanation. And it's so unusual, and this was published in Science as a biology paper, which is very unusual, that this kind of view that says, forget all that gene stuff. I work on those as well, I know they're there, I know they're doing this, but the key explanatory principle here is bifurcation, not this network, this ever-growing network of 100 things that interact. Yes, that implements it, but that's the key. And so I would say, whether you call that holistic or not, I don't know, but it's condensing down the properties of the whole system into a system-wide, not an entity, but a system-wide process. It's a process that generates a particular type of bifurcation, and that's what matters. So, and there are other examples I could give, but yeah.
Sorry. You mentioned organisms whose phenotype will be affected by elements in the environment,
yeah,
over and above the genotype. And the remarkable thing was that these changes in the phenotype can be inherited. Mm-hmm. But you also mentioned that these changes don't affect the genotype. Mm-hmm. If inheritance takes place through the genotype, how is it that these changes in morphology and in phenotype are transmitted, inherited?
Because you're also inheriting initial conditions. So you inherit the genotype codes for a dynamical system. So if you think in terms of a set of differential equations, you inherit a set of differential equations. But to actually generate a trajectory from a set of differential equations, you need initial conditions as well, or boundary conditions. PDE or whatever, you know, mathematically, the system is not just described by the equations, it's described by the conditions as well. And differential equations will generate different trajectories given different initial conditions. And so you actually inherit the initial conditions as well. And the actual mechanism of that can vary. So it may be that you actually inherit things in the cytoplasm of cells that set up initial conditions. Very often what you inherit are actual slight chemical modifications to the DNA, which is what epigenetics has come to mean, although it was originally intended as a much broader concept introduced by Waddington. But it's now come to mean its particular modifications, chemical modifications of bits of DNA that are inherited. And those can actually block expression of genes without, basically in a context-independent way. So they can be stably inherited. And that's how you get things like maternal diet changes, you know, lifetime propensities for particular diseases. So what your mother eats while she's pregnant will actually determine your lifetime propensities to certain things because of these epigenetic changes. Not to your genes, but to the context.
Okay, what else?
I don't know if you remember that, but in Bohm's 51 textbook, Quantum Theory, he asked there that we should look at the properties of things like electrons, potentialities that are unrealized according to the, you know, like whether it's wave or particle, yeah, would depend on the context. And I thought that's quite nicely analogous to what you were saying about genes. And
yes.
Have you thought of making that connection, perhaps?
That connection's been made in my head.
Right, okay.
Can I make it in any concrete way at the moment? I'm not sure. I mean, yes, you can draw analogies.
At least you could say there's a kind of analogy between the levels, a kind of unity of science, so that even, you know, the same principle would go all the way down.
Definitely. So a principle in terms of the perspective that you take on this, yes, definitely. How to actually realize that in terms of mechanism is, I think, much more difficult and much more open to question as to whether there are technical mechanistic links in the way that these two work. I would say it's just a natural principle. It's a principle of the organization of natural systems. And physical systems and biological systems are not distinct. Biological systems are physical systems, after all. They're not somehow in a different realm. They're just rather complicated physical systems. So yeah, the links there from Pope, definitely.